Series. For over 6 years, we have been investigating the work of people shattering the boundaries between art, science, and technology. In our new Art Science Gallery, which is right next door, our goal is to shift perspectives about the ways that science and technology are influencing our lives, our culture, and our world. We are extremely pleased to be presenting this afternoon's program and to be doing so in partnership with World Music Crash Arts. At the 2009 United Nations Climate Change Conference in Copenhagen, officials from Tuvalu made international headlines with their emotional plea to world leaders to stand up and acknowledge the effect that climate change was having on their island homes. Judy Matoma, director of the UCLA Center for Intercultural Performance, conceived Water is Rising to help the voices of Tuvalu, Tokelau, and Kiribati be heard. After 3 years of research, consultation with village chiefs, island councils, and government officials, the first delegation of performers from Kiribati, Tokelau, and Tuvalu has arrived in the United States. They are presenting the most exciting music and dance traditions of the Pacific, but they are also bringing attention to the plight of these atoll cultures. We're very honored to host the Water is Rising group on this, their final stop on their 14-city U.S. tour. It is a rare privilege for all of us to hear from these Pacific Islanders who are so directly affected by global warming. I'd like to now turn the stage over to our host and moderator, Eli Kintisch. Eli has been a reporter at Science Magazine for 6 years. He has given talks on geoengineering and climate change policy to audiences at the American Geophysical Union, Columbia University, the National Center for Atmospheric Research, and the American Association for the Advancement of Science. He is currently a Knight Science Journalism Fellow at MIT, and he is shifting his reporter's focus from getting the story to working with artists, designers, and scientists to come up with new ways of effectively communicating information about climate change in order to reach and have an impact on a very large segment of the general public. We are very fortunate to have this innovative and passionate thinker calling Boston home this year. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Eli Kintisch.
Thank you all for joining us. I think we should have the participants come for the discussion right now. So for most of us, climate change, why don't you each do this? For most of us, climate change is a slow, distant phenomenon, which we believe touches our lives only when we choose to consider it. The effects we have begun to notice in the rich, developed part of the world include the movement of some species, some health impacts, warmer weather, and shorter winters. And of course, if you look closely, rising seas. Indeed, the water is rising. Though they are not known exactly, the effects of this inexorable rise, right now measured at 2 millimeters per year, will be vast over the next century. 1 in 10 of the world's citizens live within a low coastal zone, defined as within 30 feet of the coast. But millions live closer than that. The Pacific atolls that dot Oceania, with most inhabitants living within 2 meters of the sea, are certainly threatened. But the story is not simple. In general, the sea is not rising faster there than anywhere else on the planet. There's no exceptional record thus far of major erosion on the islands. Water has washed clear across these islands during storms for many centuries. But these storms can sometimes even add to the size of the islands after the cyclones passed. The problem is that 2 meters per year could accelerate in the future, and some islands are also sinking in certain places. So long before these islands are completely covered in water, the protective wall of coral surrounds them. But that protective wall itself is slowly getting covered as the water rises. And that protective wall of coral was calculated in a paper published 2 years ago to basically be at risk of being inundated by 2070. So I asked a geologist today about this situation. He's from Arizona. His name is Bill Dickinson. And the message he wanted to give you was, on the one hand, these islands are not disappearing at a furious rate right now. He said, they're going to be in trouble long before the sea level overtops the island, however. So with us today to talk about these issues and to share the stories from their islands are Andrew Semeli of Tuvalu. That's Andrew. Francis Tabau of Kiribati. Michaele Maiava of Tokelau. And from a little closer, Aaron Bernstein, also known as Avi, from Harvard Medical School's Health and Global Environmental Change Program. So I think I'd like to start the discussion by simply asking, as I'm sure many of the people in the audience here are wondering, why tell your story through dance? Why and songs? What meaning did that have, and what made you think that this is the right way to explain what's happening?
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Before I start to ask the question, I would like to greet you all in this very afternoon in Tuvalu, Talofa Olua. Talking about cultures, traditions, these are the factors that we value most, the way of life we are living back home. But bringing music and dance to the United States, it is a matter of spreading the voice, spreading the message through the words that we use or we put in the middle, in most of the songs. Because we were brought up with dance and music, and it's so important to us. It is part of our life. Every day of our life, we teach how to dance. We teach our people how to sing. And that's how important our music and dance to us. And that's why we bring music and dance to deliver the message of climate change to the outside world. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, first of all, I would like to thank this great opportunity to share with you some ideas of our island. Yes, like you said about the culture, singing and dancing. Yes, I remember the back in Kiribati, and there's canoe racing, and because we always have a canoe racing each year, and you know, the one of the fishermen, he really wants to win this race, and he never had this chance to win. So he find a way to win, and so he composed a song, and he composed a song that he believed that with this song he will win this race. So we can see that in Kiribati we believe in music and dance. And that's why we came here with our music and dance. We believe that we can fight climate change through our songs and dance.
You know, we've toured about 14 different campuses now, and you know, seeing, I've been to universities also, and you know, in class, you always sit in class, you know. And I think combining that with joy, But this is something that we really enjoy back home. And if we enjoy it in every day of our life, you see, somebody is down, then you sing a song and suddenly you're up again. You know, and you see someone, you know, in a funeral, somebody singing and everybody have the strength again. So I think with our dance and our singing, I think it's good to remind people that it's not just up here. You know, it's not just up here trying to figure out what the solution. But I think it's important that you include it with joy. Something that you really love doing, like our dance and our songs. So when we got this opportunity from Trudy, we thought like, this is it, this is the moment that we've been waiting for. This is how we can actually get out there, because in the small islands, you don't really have the chance to get out there and pay a ticket to go around the world, right? Because we don't have money to pay for it, to go and give our voices. So this is really, really the best opportunity. Thank you.
I want to now turn to Avi. Avi, why don't you talk a little bit about the challenges related to climate change that these islands face?
Well, I was actually going to start by saying, in response to your first question, is it sounds like I need to do some more singing and dancing. As far as the challenges, I'm not a very good dancer, so that would, I could definitely learn something from these guys. You know, what's interesting about having the opportunity to be here today is that I have spent many years now trying to make it clear that what's at stake with climate change is not simply sea level rise or more intense storms or changes to the availability of food, but ultimately it's about our own health. And the people that are with us today are the human face of that, because they are living that reality in a way that's very clear. And so it's really an extraordinary opportunity for everyone here to witness this incredibly vibrant culture, which actually I've already learned is each of these islands has its own distinct, nuanced set of both dances and cultural practices, which you'll see. But that this climatic change that is the result of our putting mostly the byproducts of fossil fuels into the air, so-called greenhouse gases, is actually an issue not just for the environment, but for ourselves. And the challenge we face ultimately is to grasp that it is in fact just that. It is not an environmental problem per se. It's really about our way of life and what we want to see for our way of life. And so this today's event is really a wonderful way for people to understand, to see it sort of very first time. And to me, that's our greatest challenge. Until we recognize that something is at stake for ourselves, we're going to have a very hard time feeling motivated, either if we live in the United States or anywhere else in the world, we're going to have a very hard time feeling motivated to do what's necessary to deal with the problem.
I want to maybe step back a little. People in the audience may be curious a little bit about the history of these dances. Just briefly, Michaele, could you say a little bit about how old the dances and songs from your culture is, and how long have your people lived Tokelau?
How long that people been living there? My history for that, all I know is that my mom told me that we've been there for whenever they remember, you know? Like it's from long time ago, very long time ago. But the singing and dancing part, some of the dances and the songs that we have, I remember I'm 33 years old, and I remember singing this song when I was only 10. So it's even older than that, you know, some of the songs. And some of the songs that we have to compose, like any other song, you have to compose according to the purpose. So when we were given the criteria, or we were given the purpose of the tour, the water is rising and what it's about for climate change, and also culture. And so we think of the song that actually tells a lot about the culture in one song. And with those songs, it's so special because not only you hear the lyrics, But then in the lyrics, you had to gracefully move to it. So you are actually telling the story while you're singing it, and at the same time, you are actually picturing yourself in what you're singing. So like singing about fishing out there and bringing the catch back so that we can divide it to the children, caring for our children, their generation to come. So you have that all part of that feeling is within you while you are singing and that. So you never forget the song.
I was struck last night, it was said between some of, I don't know how many people here were at Harvard where they had a full performance, it was said that on one of these islands, I don't remember, maybe all three, but maybe one can identify it, that after the catch is brought back to the island, as you said, Michaele, it's divided equally among everyone, whether or not you were a fisherman or your brother was a fisherman. And that struck me because I think right now with the effects of climate change, we're not seeing equal distribution of wealth, nor equal distribution of risk. And I wonder if you have any, if you want to comment about that. I mean, in a way, you are you are facing some of the most severe effects of, you know, rising seas soonest. Do you have any comments about that?
Speaking in the case of Tuvalu, we have faced with lots of difficulties. But going back to the question that was asked by the moderator to Michaele, how long our people been there? Our history, our people was existed before 1568, when the first Spanish captain, D. Mendana, first sighted the island of Moon. That's in 1568. And he was found that our people already exist in our country. He also found out that our cultures and traditions already exist on our land. And since then until now, we still maintain those cultures and traditions in music and dance. Some of the music and dance that composed in those days, we're still maintaining. We're still using it in some functions. But we still also are composing new songs. Time has changed, and we learn lots of new things, and we compose new songs to deliver the message according to the purpose of the day or the events that we are going to perform. And coming to how we share our needs, I mean, how we share our resources, it is very difficult for us to see how developing countries share their resources to us, small developing countries. Just recently, Tuvalu faced with a long drought, and our people having a very difficult life, looking for drinking water. And this was a very hard life to our people. And the government of the day gave a ration of 1 gallon per person per day for every people, for every needs. I mean, for drinking, washing, and all of the whatever you want to use from this 1 gallon per day. So the life is very difficult when coming to drought. But even though we announce or we declare a state of emergency, only few developed countries willing to assist. We are so fortunate that the Australian government and the New Zealand government are able to assist us during this drought. But we can see that this is some of the evidence of the changing of the climate. Because we haven't been experienced these long droughts before. This is the first state of emergency declared by the government of Tuvalu for running out of drinking water. And to be distributed resources to those who affected their life, it's very difficult to receive some of the assistance from others. So that's what I can say in terms of droughts. Thank you.
Avi, talk a little bit about maybe some specifics about, you mentioned health impacts. We think of sea level rise as one of the first impacts, but you studied what health impacts were already seen. Why don't you talk about that?
What's interesting is that if you look at what makes us healthy, climate change affects all. There's not a part of our health, mental or physical, that is not affected by climate change. And I think it's important to realize that, in my mind, when I think about people who have to live in places like the South Pacific, sea level rise is actually not the clear present danger of the moment. In fact, issues like drought may very well be. But there's a much more concerning, to me personally, issue, which is the acidification of the oceans. Many of you will know that when you dissolve carbon dioxide is the single most important gas that's warming our atmosphere, produced by burning fossil fuels primarily. When you dissolve that in water, it makes it more acidic, and our oceans, the world's oceans, have actually already become more acidic. And there's a problem with that, which is that many organisms, including ourselves, make their skeletons out of calcium carbonate, and calcium carbonate dissolves in acid. So those coral reefs you're referring to, Eli, they have calcium carbonate backbones. And I imagine that most of your peoples rely primarily on fish as the primary source of protein in your diet. You're not eating beef, you're not eating chicken, as people in the United States would. And those fish, in order to grow up, need coral reefs. And so, again, in terms of nutrition, globally, to me, the greatest issue with health is nutrition, particularly for people who are primarily relying upon seafood. That's about 1 in 6 people rely primarily on seafood for protein. But climate change has immense effects upon our ability to harvest grain. So droughts and floods, two things we're seeing more of as the planet warms. Very difficult to grow food on land. Of course, raising livestock in droughts and so forth. So there are about another 1 billion people in the world who are undernourished right now. And as we add climate change into the mix, it makes feeding those people who are already undernourished yet harder. I'm not going to go through all the health effects, but the reality is that we have a tremendous choice right now about the path we're on. And what I think about in terms of our choices today is it's sort of like a growing tree. And when that tree comes out of the ground, it has the potential to go left or right or straight up. And if the wind is blowing in one direction, as it grows, it's going to bend this way. But by the time it's an adult tree, it's going to curve way off to the side. And that's where we are right now. The choices we make today have effects not in the near term, in the next 10 years, 20 years. They have effects for centuries. Sea level rise is 1.8 to 2 millimeters per year, roughly, right now. We're looking at maybe a baseball bat length of sea level rise by 2100. But by 2200, we have to understand that these greenhouse gases stay in the atmosphere a very long time, looking at 4 to 6 meters of sea level rise. And so again, this tree that's growing up right now is affected in ways that are going to be manifesting over the next many decades. Tremendously important that we understand that, because that makes the importance of acting now. For many people in the United States, climate change is seen as a problem way off in the future. It affects the health of the children I see at Children's Hospital Boston every day. terms of the air quality they have to breathe, allergens in the air. And these are completely avoidable problems. And as a pediatrician, I think my primary job is preventing illness. And so I look at a problem like climate change and I say, we have so much illness to prevent here, which we can really make a difference with by the choices we make today.
What struck me last night watching your moving and energetic performances was how happy you looked. And most Americans, when they think about climate change and sea level rise and global warming and storms, it's a very depressing topic. So I want to hear from you, what is behind that smile? And how can you inspire us to feel more hope or to connect that with action, perhaps?
Thank you. You know, the back in Kiribati, we know that climate change is really affecting the people on the island. But even though that is the problem they are facing, but the people on the island are always willing to fight. They don't want to just stand and sit and do nothing. They always want to fight against those problems in life, not just only that. You know, back in my island, we have come across many problems. Blackbirds, when they took many of our people in Kiribati. The World War II, we have survived World War II, when the Americans fought the Japanese on Tarawa, where I live. And also, we have survived phosphate mining when they took phosphate from one of our islands, which is Panama. So you can see that the people on the island, they are always willing to fight. They are always willing to fight against any kind of problem they are being affected by. So that is where you can see it. Through their singing and dancing.
I also just want to add on what Francis said. You know, it's all about communion, the community. In Tokelau, you grow up, you don't have one parent. You know, you have everybody's your parent. And everybody, they help you. So when you're down, maybe you can't do it, but then the other can help you. So you keep this community living. You know, you live in a community and everybody care for each other. They love each other. That's the way we grow up. And we do everything with a smile. I think I would prefer to keep smiling than crying all the time. You know? So like I said, in a dance, we use the dance. When I feel sad, I dance and I sing the song, you know? And also the inati system linking to this is like, when we go out fishing, maybe I'm sleeping, right? When they come back, they don't question me why you're sleeping in there. But what is important to them is that we take care of the village. We take care of every individual. So in America, you are the biggest contributor to carbon emission. And you don't even care, you know? You just think to yourself, and that's it. As in the island, we think of everyone. It's not just you. So the inati system, when it comes back, it doesn't matter you are sleeping because you're gonna go fishing the next day, but you will still get your share. That everybody lives happily, so no one is down. In America, you get your one and say, "I'm sorry, you can go and work for yourself." I mean, it's hard. I'm not comparing America to Tokelau, but from a community, I think it can work, right? It can work in a family, it can work for your extended family, and so on and so on. So you contribute a lot, and I think what we really want to for the United States of America's people to realize is that your actions affect not only yourself, but it affects on us even much more.
My last question for you is, what do you see in the future? There are some pretty scary predictions the scientists are making about the effects on your island. What do you see for the future of your country?
I'm speaking from the my own personal view. What I can see in the future, I put Tuvalu as a question mark. If we can stand up on our foot and do something, and there is a hope for Tuvalu to continue enjoying their cultures and traditions in the future. But if we still ignore the voices of others, and there's a question mark, but we are not panicked fighting against climate change. Back at home, we are trying our very best to do what we can to maintain our own land, to uphold our own land. We replant most of the biggest trees near the coastal line just to hold up the land from erosion flooding. We also do most of some projects which is most helps to prevent our land from flooding and erosion. Also, we try our very best to contribute less to carbon emission, even though we contribute less, but we want to contribute more or less than what we contribute today. We already installed some solar power system. In Tuvalu, 10% of the power distribution to household from solar power system, and 90% from fossil fuel. But we are trying our very best to turn our electricity into our solar system in the coming future. Thank you.
I just like adding to what my brother here have just said, because back in Kiribati, we're really being affected by climate change, and there is one island in Kiribati that is that island is called Pigaman, and about 15 years ago, I still remember that island. Because me and my family used to go on that island and have picnics. And not only our family, but all of the people in Tarawa, they used the island for picnics. And but now, that island is no longer exists. And it's just only a small beach right now. So, you know, the people on the island, they think of the future to leave Kiribati, but some they don't want to leave. They just want to stay on the island. And one of my cousin, she's now in New Zealand, and I really would like to thank the government of New Zealand, because he also offered the Kiribati people It invites people to live on New Zealand, but it's only 30 people each year, and if you could imagine, we have about 120,000 people in Kiribati. So I think that is not a solution to climate change. And my cousin, she went to New Zealand, and she don't want to live in Kiribati she is afraid of climate change. And I don't blame her. I blame you, Americans, Chinese people, big developed countries, because of that.
Share with you the story. It's not going to be a long story, but it's, when you are born on the island, you've heard this, or you haven't heard this last night, but when you're born on the island, the first thing that comes out of the room is an umbilical cord in a basin. And this one is given to your family, and your brother, your sister, your parent decide who takes this. They take it to your land, they dig a hole, they put it there and plant a coconut tree or any tree that is edible. That tree grows there. That is our connection to the land. When this tree dies, it's already born other trees. So, before year 2000, we heard that the scientists say, there's gonna be no more Tokelau after 2000. We're gonna sink. You know what we did? By the night of the millennium, everybody was instructed to go out to the ocean side and wait there and wear something white. You know, it's even though it was sad, but we were so happy. So the wheelbarrow, you push your grandmother, everybody goes to the ocean side, and then we sit there. And then we just talk about, oh, I wonder how high the wave's gonna be. Maybe that much. And this is not no joke. This is what really happened. You know? And then I'm trying to tell you what's gonna happen in the future. So after that moment, when the sun rose, we were sitting there drinking tea, singing songs after the prayer, after the church. Everybody looked at each other, it was about 10 to 11 a.m., we look at each other and I said, what are we doing here? Let's go back home and cook our food, and let's go and do our everyday life. So from that moment, we knew what to do. We are just going to stay put on the island. We're going to do what we can to save our island. And we, in the Tokelau National Strategic Plan, we are turning Tokelau to say goodbye to fossil fuel by 2013 as the first nation to depend on renewable energy only. That's our future. So the question is, do you realize that this is not about climate change only? This is about people's lives. And that is the fundamental why we're here. This is people's lives you are talking about. This is not houses go underwater. This is not trees go underwater. This is people's lives go underwater. So the question is, what are you going to do about that? As America is the biggest contributor, China is even growing even further. We have the bad news about the 2 millimeter water rising. What are you going to do about it, Americans?
I now open the questions. You can't quite see where the microphone is.
I have the microphone right up here. So if you all raise your hands for if anyone has a question, I'll bring the mic over.
Thank you. First of all, I wanted to say Yahweh from the Marshall Islands, which is where I call home. And so I was able to see the performance last night, and I just want to say, and thank you very much. I feel so blessed to have shared in that experience. I wanted to ask, because the Marshall Islands are neighbors and they're facing the same fate, the government has been, a lot of people have been asking the government to come up with a national strategy like you were talking about. And one of the things that they've been asked to think about is a official relocation program. And the Marshallese people right now have basically refused to consider relocation as an option, even though they're allowed to come to the United States freely. They say that they will never consider a formal program because to leave the islands would be basically to just to die, because land is the most important thing in their culture. And so I wanted to ask what's happening in your countries in terms of, are people even thinking about relocation? I know 30 people a year, you know, to New Zealand. Is this something that people even want to do? I mean, to leave is death for a lot of people. So I wanted to ask if that's helpful.
Thank you very much. You know, the people in Kiribati, some of the people in Kiribati want to leave the island. But I think most of them don't want to leave. You know, the reason why they don't want to leave is the, I met one people from here during the show last night, and he told me that, so you really want to stay on your island? And I said to him, yes. But he told me, but what's the problem if we take you to America and to live on America? And I told him, yes, we can, but you know, when I first came here, I've never seen the ocean. I never seen the ocean in here. When I first came here till now, I've never seen the ocean. And you know, our lives, our dancing, our singing depends on where we live, depends on the ocean, depends in everything. You know, we dance like we keep our fishing methods, our skills. So if we come here, we don't have the ocean here, how can we remain our culture, our skills, and everything that we have from our ancestors? That's why we don't want to leave our land.
You know, relocation is such a Western thing to me. You know, it's so European, it's so not my culture. You know, you talk about relocation people, it's like you get your suitcase and you walk over and you live in your auntie's house. People, you're talking about land is gone. Your life is pretty much gone. This is not our question. Our question is that, how can we survive this? That's the question you need to be asking now, not about how can we relocate them? Gone the days of colonialism. Gone the days of people telling us what to do. These are the day for our people to stand up and say, you are polluting the environment. You are not doing your part in the UNFCCC. You are not doing your part in the Kyoto Protocol. Do something. Because this is not a question that we ask. So, you know, just hearing this story, what are we going to do coming to America or going to New Zealand? Joining the mob? Joining the street people? What are we, you have problems of your own. You want us to come and be here and be another problem? So, you know, it is a problem that we all face. Are we really, really thinking that you want to think that these people that is here today would want to leave their island? No.
The next question's over here.
Aloha kākou. I'm a native Hawaiian, and fortunately for at least ourselves, we have tall mountains that we can retreat to when it gets, if it gets, which I don't think is going to be that great a concern, of certainly a concern. My question is, I understand that concurrent with the APEC conference in Honolulu last week was also the Moana Nui conference. and that an organization I'm affiliated with met and talked story with the contingent from your island nations. What expectations did you folks have, and where they met, and realistically in education, how effective do you believe this is? And another question also to the medical community as it relates to making statements in support of climate warming. So that's directed to Mr. Bernstein as well, secondly.
Okay, let's hear about recent political efforts. Are you optimistic with these recent meetings?
We're sick of meetings. You know, when they came with the Kyoto Protocol here in the Clinton time, the representative voted it not, you know, put it under the chair and let's just keep going with the economic growth. You know, all this, that is why this project was the best project to raise awareness. If without this project, people like you wouldn't actually feel the human face of climate change. You were just looking at your television in your room and look like, oh, okay, it's just number. As 2 meters this way, the rice is gonna come this way. Oh, it's just number. Makes sense. But we actually don't realize who's on that island. So while we are optimistic about, we're optimistic about what the world is trying to do, and especially the big countries like America, I don't know about China. While we're optimistic that we're gonna do something about it, we really like to see actions. We really like to see it, and we really like to see the science and the arts and everything that we can do to raise the awareness. You know, because I know that in America, they have been even doing a campaign that climate change is not real. That's why the mentality of the people here is not coming to realization. Once you step out of that and seeing this beautiful culture, this beautiful dance, you realize we are just the same as you.
I think we have time for one more question, then we've got final performances we're all excited about.
So I have the last question right over here.
Hi, I thank you very much for your coming and telling us in your own words. There are people here, and probably most in this auditorium, understand your problems. We have Smith Island in Maryland that is also disappearing, and the atolls up in Alaska are having their problems, the Aleutian Islands. So we do hear it, and a lot of us are working through our organizations here, National Wildlife Sierra Club, all of those organizations, to try and help you and hear your plight. And all I can say is, unfortunately, this country has been taken over by the big corporations now, and we are really struggling to fight against that, the money interests that are polluting our thinking as well as our way of lives and appreciating how to take care of each other. So thank you for your presentation.
Thank our panelists, and now I think we have some time for the two groups, for Kate Gale Mai Nokononu from Tokelau and Paolo Milu from Tuvalu. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Thank you. Hello, everybody. We are the people from Tuvalu. Our first item is the song I composed for the voting rights. My name is Samola. I'm the composer in my area. I compose so many songs, but this song is a very important song to my life because I composed it with my tears. Because I love my island.
Oh,
Thank you to Elon
joining in the conversation, but mostly thank you for your courage and your hope.